Hi friends, in today's video I will be discussing about audit provisions under the Goods and Services Tax. If you're new to my channel, kindly subscribe for latest updates related to GST. So let's get started. Now, when we look at the definition which is provided under the CGST Act of 2017, Section 2, Subsection 13, it deals with the definition of audit. So as per Section 2, Subsection 13 of CGST Act 2017, audit means examination of records, returns and other documents which are maintained or furnished by the registered person under this act or the rule. This act meaning CGST Act. To verify the correctness of the turnover which is declared, the taxes paid, the refund which is claimed and the input tax credit which has been availed, and to assess the compliance with provisions of this act on the rules which are made thereunder. So audit is basically examination of the records and returns which are furnished by the registered person and to verify the correctness of the turnover which the registered person declares or the taxes which he pays, the refund which has been claimed or the input tax credit which has been availed, and to assess the compliance with the provisions of the GST Act, that is the CGST Act, or the rules which are CGST rules which are made thereunder. So this is basically what audit means. Now when we move further into the GST audit is required under the following three circumstances. First, audit by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant, which is covered by Section 35, Subsection 5. Second type of audit is by the tax authorities, which is covered under Section 65. And third is a special audit, which is covered under Section 66. So we will cover all the three types of audit in this video. Moving by the first one, which is audit by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant under Section 35, Subsection 5. As per Section 35, Subsection 5 of the CGST Act 2017, every registered person whose turnover during a financial year exceeds the prescribed limit shall get his accounts audited by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant and shall submit a copy of the audited annual accounts and also reconciliation statement, which is provided under Section 44 of the CGST Act, in the prescribed form and manner. Now, when we talk about prescribed limit, Rule 80 of the CGST Rules 2017, it states the prescribed limit, which is 2 crores. So, if your turnover is more 2 crore or more than 2 crores, then Section 35 will be applicable to you and you have to get the GST audit done by a CA or a CMA. Now when we were talking about this audit, we came across another section, which is Section 44, which talks about reconciliation statement. So when we move on to Section 44, Section 44 states that every registered person who is required to get his accounts audited. So Section 35 talks about audit. Section 44 says that every person who is required to get his accounts audited in accordance with provisions of subsection 5, Section 35, such registered person has to furnish an annual return under Section 44, Subsection 1 of the CGST Act, along with a copy of the audited annual accounts and a reconciliation statement. So, if your turnover is more than 2 crores, you have to get yourself audited under GST provisions and also you have to furnish an annual return along with the copy of audited annual accounts and a reconciliation statement. Now, we have come across under both the sections, Section 35, Subsection 5 and Section 44, Subsection 2, a statement named as a reconciliation statement. Now, what is a reconciliation statement? Reconciliation statement, it's a statement which reconciles the value of the supplies which are declared in the return furnished for the financial year with the audited annual financial statements. So the value of supplies which you have declared in your GST returns which you have filed over the financial year and your audited financial statements, the reconciliation statement will state if there are any differences in such data which you have supplied in your GST return and with that of your audited financial statements. So basically the government gets an idea about whether you have stated correct facts in your GST returns by comparing it with your annual financial statements. And a reconciliation statement is thereby required by the government to see if there are any mismatch between the GST return and that of your financial statement. And also the reasons if there are any such financial statements can be ascertained by the government. So when we talk about the reconciliation statements, Rule 80 of CGST Rules 2017 states that every registered person whose aggregate turnover during a financial year exceeds 2 crore rupees shall get his accounts audited as specified in the subsection 5 of section 35, and he shall furnish a copy of audited annual accounts and a reconciliation statement duly certified in form GSTR 9C. So the taxpayer has to furnish a reconciliation statement between the financial results, that is the audited financial results, and the GST returns for the balances as on the date of financial statement. So you have to give details, suppose, of the input tax credit along with reasons if there are any differences between the taxes applicable in GST. So if there are any difference between the ITCs, you have to give a clarification in that, why there is a difference. If there is any difference between your financial results, the figures you have provided in your financial accounts and the figures which you have submitted in your GST returns, you have to give a clarification regarding that in the reconciliation statement. So this is applicable only for those assessees whose turnover exceeds 2 crore rupees. Now, we have discussed regarding these annual returns and audit. Everywhere is stated every registered person. So every registered person, if suppose there is a company, it has 4 different branches. In one branch, the turnover is more than 2 crores. Other branches, it has turnovers which are less than 2 crores. Suppose one branch has 2 crores, 20 lakhs, and other branches have 10 lakhs of turnover. The other branches are situated in different states, so it has to obtain different registrations. So in that case, as per this reading of the section and the rules, I am of the view that is only that particular branch which is having a turnover of more than 2 crore has to get itself audited, not the other branches which are separately registered, because it says that every registered person. So if XYZ, it has a branch at Delhi which has a turnover of 2.2 crores, it has to get itself registered, it is registered, and thereby it has to get itself audited under GST. But XYZ also has other branches in states of, suppose, in UP, one in MP, one in Maharashtra. It has turnover of less than 2 crore rupees. Then those branches are not required, because say every registered person in each of those branches are separately registered. So this is from this reading of this section, we can take that view that it's not that the entire organization has to get each of his branches audited. Is only that particular branch or registered branch which is having a turnover of more than 2 crores of that particular financial year. But in some places also, we get a view that it's a PAN-based, it can be a PAN-based GST audit. In that case, all the branches, whether it's less than 2 crore or more than 2 crores, if all the branches club together under one PAN, the turnover of that particular PAN exceeds 2 crore, it has to get itself audited. So it's not now very much, no clarification is not been given by the government. We shouldn't expect a clarification to be there. So when we move on to a special audit, as per section 66 of the CGST Act 2017, if at any stage of a scrutiny, inquiry, investigation or any other proceeding before him, and any officer who is not below the rank of an assistant commissioner, having regard to the nature and complexity of the case and the interest of the revenue, is of the opinion that the value which has been declared or the credit which has been availed is not within the limits or has been incorrectly declared, then such officer, not below the rank of assistant commissioner, he can, with the prior approval of the commissioner, direct the registered person by communication in writing to get his records, including the books of accounts, examined and audited by a chartered accountant or a cost accountant, as may be nominated by the commissioner. So this is the provisions of special audit. Now there is also a time limit. The chartered accountant or the cost accountant who is so nominated, they shall within 90 days submit a report of the audit duly signed and certified by him to the said assistant commissioner, mentioning therein such other particulars as may be specified. The assistant commissioner, on the application made to him in this behalf by registered person or the chartered accountant or cost accountant, may also extend the period by further 90 days. That is, total period in no case can exceed 180 days. So the expenses for the such examination and audit of the records will be determined and will be paid by the commissioner, and it will be final also. Third type of audit is by the tax authorities. Section 65 subsection 1 deals with this audit. It states that the commissioner or any officer who is authorized by him by way of a general or a specific order undertake audit of any registered person for such period and such frequency as may be prescribed. And again, as may be prescribed, the rules will be stated. So the officer, he may conduct the audit at place of business of the registered person or in their office. And the officer has to inform the registered person by at least 15 days notice prior to the conduct of such audit. The audit has to be conducted within 3 months from date of commencement of the audit, provided that where commissioner is satisfied that audit in respect to such registered person cannot be completed in such 3 months period, he can extend it to 6 months maximum. So within 3 months he has to complete the audit. Extension can be made by the commissioner by further 6 months, making it total of 9 months, a total maximum time limit. When the proper officer he concludes the audit, he has to within 30 days inform registered persons his findings, the rights and obligations of such person and the reasons for such findings. Now, if it results in detection of tax not paid or short paid or which has been erroneously refunded or input tax credit which has been wrongly availed, the proper officer may initiate action in section 73, 74 of the CGST Act regarding the recovery proceedings of such tax which has not been paid or which has been short paid or ITC has been wrongly availed. So these were the provisions regarding the audit. If you have any further questions regarding audit provisions, you can always contact me at my mail address, which is provided in the description box below. Also, you can connect with me at my Twitter handle. The link is provided in the description box, and also on my Facebook page, which is link is provided in the description box. Thank you. If you want further GST updates, kindly drop in your mail addresses in the comment section below. Thank you.